What really stuns me is that none of the pilots understood the aircraft was stalling. And if you do not understand you are in a stall, you cannot recover. Hello aviators, how are you today? My name is Magnar Nordal, I'm an ATR captain and instructor. There has been a lot of talk about the performance of ATR aircraft in icing conditions. In previous videos, like this one, I have pointed out that aside from the American Eagle Flight 4184 accident caused by a combination of severe icing and a design flaw in the wing de-icing system, which has since been addressed and corrected, every other icing-related incident involving ATR aircraft happened because the flight crew did not maintain a safe airspeed, resulting in a stall, and then they failed to follow the correct stall recovery procedure. Not only did the pilots fail to follow the published stall recovery procedure, but they were also fighting against the stick pressure. The stick pressure is designed to prevent the aircraft from stalling when the angle of attack becomes dangerously high. When it activates, it pushes the control column forward to lower the nose and restore airflow over the wings. However, for some reason, pilots have instinctively pulled back on the control column, which prevents or delays the aircraft's recovery from the stall. Let me give you an example. A report from the Transportation Safety Board of Canada details an incident that took place in May 2005, involving a stall and also controlling icing conditions. The aircraft, operated by Provincial Airlines Limited, was on a scheduled passenger flight from St. John's to Deer Lake, Newfoundland and Labrador, with 39 people on board. During the climb out of St. John's, the indicated airspeed gradually dropped, leading to an aerodynamic stall. The aircraft then entered a rapid descent, losing 4,200 feet in 40 seconds before the crew regained control. Fortunately, there were no injuries and the aircraft suffered no damage. I will read some extracts from the report. Before departure, the flight crew checked the en route weather, the graphic area forecast, GFA, for icing, turbulence and freezing level, depicted the freezing level at 10,000 feet. The GFA indicated the possibility of nil to light icing above the freezing level, and light to nil turbulence. There were no pilot reports or significant meteorological reports issued advising of icing conditions or turbulence on the planned route. The aircraft took off from St. John's at 17:39. After takeoff, the captain, who was pilot flying, engaged the autopilot. Flight data recorded data showed that when the autopilot was engaged, the indicated airspeed was 162 knots and the rate of climb was 1190 feet per minute. After autopilot engagement, the rate of climb remained constant, while the indicated airspeed fluctuated slowly between 160 and 170 knots indicated airspeed. After the aircraft was established in the climb on the outbound heading, the first officer commenced the paperwork necessary for the departure airport. At around 7,000 feet, the crew selected the engine ice protection systems on. However, they elected to leave the pneumatic de-icing system on the wings off. The crew was looking for ice accumulation, but none was detected. Through about 8,000 feet, the airspeed started to gradually decrease from 170 knots over a period of 5 minutes. During this time, the vertical speed continued at a constant 1190 feet per minute. The gradual decrease in airspeed was detected when the first officer looked up from his paperwork, noted the decreased airspeed, and advised the captain. The captain then rotated the pitch control wheel of the flight guidance controller toward nose down to increase the airspeed. While attempting the adjustment, the aircraft stick shaker activated, causing the autopilot to disengage. This occurred at 14,800 feet above sea level, at 104 knots. Within a second of autopilot disengagement, the aircraft began to roll right and pitch down. The roll angle increased to 64 degrees. The pitch angle went from 15 degrees nose up to 15 degrees nose up. And the aircraft vertical acceleration dropped to approximately 0.5 g. The aircraft pitch then increased to 30 degrees nose up briefly before decreasing to 40 degrees nose down. These conditions are indications that the aircraft wing had fully stalled. However, the captain interpreted the indications as severe turbulence. The flight data recorded data showed that the aircraft underwent three distinct stalls, with the third stall being the most severe. The data showed that the control column position cycled rapidly back and forth as the stall developed, but was moved generally aft, remaining aft during all three stalls. Aircraft control was regained when the control column was moved forward. An aircraft stall airspeed increases as a result of ice contamination. According to the flight manual, the stall speed for the aircraft's configuration and weight was 94.5 knots indicated airspeed. However, the aircraft stalled very shortly after the stick shaker activation at about 103 knots. During the loss of control, there were heavy control column forces and severe buffeting. The aircraft descended rapidly, losing 4,200 feet before recovery was effected. Immediately after recovery, the crew observed ice was building up rapidly on the aircraft. Airframe de-ice equipment was then selected on. The pneumatic boots functioned when selected and were effective in removing the ice. The crew requested a lower altitude to remain clear of icing conditions and continue to Deer Lake. After landing, the pilot reported a severe turbulence encounter to the company personnel. Many of you might assume this was another icing-related incident involving an ATR-42 or ATR-72. But it actually happened with a Dash 8. No aircraft is immune to icing. What stands out about this incident is that the captain apparently did not recognize the aircraft had stalled, even after the stick shaker had activated. Instead, he believed control had been lost due to severe turbulence. Incidents or accidents rarely occur due to a single factor. When we apply the Swiss cheese model, we can see several contributing factors that led to this event. 1. At the time of the incident, the company had only 16 months of operational experience with the aircraft type. 2. The captain had over 10,000 hours of flying experience, but only 131 hours on the Dash 8. He was paired with a first officer who had 112 hours on the type, though the report did not provide the first officer's total flying experience. Many companies typically pair pilots with less than 200 hours on a specific aircraft type with a pilot who has more than 200 hours on that type. 3. During flight, it is the pilot flying's responsibility to monitor the flight instruments and adjust the flight path as needed, while the pilot monitoring is tasked with monitoring the overall flight. However, after takeoff, the autopilot was set to vertical speed mode instead of indicated airspeed, which is standard mode for climb. Neither of the pilots noticed this. Because the company's SOP did not require a verbal challenge and response between the crew members when engaging an AFCS mode. 4. During the initial climb, the first officer began focusing on paperwork, which prevented him from fulfilling his duties as pilot monitoring. When he eventually looked up, the aircraft was dangerously close to stalling. 5. The aircraft was not equipped with an electronic ice detector or an ice evidence probe, making it more difficult to detect ice buildup on the aircraft. 6. The crew failed to activate the wing de-icing boots when they encountered icing. However, back in 1999, Transport Canada issued an advisory circular requiring air operators to update their training programs to include the following recommendation. Unless specifically prohibited by the AFM, it is recommended that pilots of turbine-powered airplanes equipped with pneumatic de-icing boots with an automatic cycle select the boots on automatic as soon as the airplane enters icing conditions. During the investigation, it was discovered that about 50% of Dash 8 pilots wait for ice to accumulate on the wings before activating the pneumatic boots. The rationale behind this practice was the belief that engaging the de-icing boots too early could cause an ice bridge to form in front of the boots, rendering them ineffective. This is an outdated myth dating back to the early days of aviation. Modern de-icing boots are designed to function effectively even with the slightest accumulation of ice. 2 months before the incident, in March 2005, both the captain and first officer completed a surface contamination and airborne icing course. This raises questions about the effectiveness of the training. In my opinion, there is an issue with how stall is taught to pilots. At the flight school, you fly a lightly loaded Cessna at a low altitude. The procedure is to reduce power to idle and let the speed bid off. When the stall warning sounds, you lower the nose slightly, add power, and level the wings. In the United States, it was a requirement from FAA that a stall recovery should be executed with minimum altitude loss. You do the same exercise in the simulator during a type rating course. In ATR aircraft, if the flaps are retracted, the stall recovery procedure also includes selecting flaps 15. But in real life, it's different. First, you're not prepared. Second, you do not induce the stall by reducing power. Third, the aircraft is usually at a high altitude where engine or propeller thrust is reduced. And finally, the aircraft is dragged down by ice. Icing has various impacts on aircraft performance. It increases the aircraft's weight, adds drag, and alters the wing's shape, reducing its ability to produce lift. Ice on the propellers will reduce the efficiency. Additionally, aircraft with jet engines will lose engine thrust when using bleed air for anti-icing equipment. And if the pitot tubes becomes blocked by ice, the indicated airspeed can become unreliable, causing confusion in the cockpit. Here's an important point to remember. Aircraft drags consist of two main components, induced drag and parasite drag. Induced drag increases with the angle of attack. It is high at low speed and low at high speeds. Parasite drag, on the other hand, is low at low speeds and increases with the square of the speed. Total drag is at its lowest at a relatively low airspeed. Propeller thrust remains relatively constant over the normal speed range. At cruise, the propeller thrust equals total drag. Now, when ice forms on the airframe, parasite drag increases, causing the cruise speed to decrease or the rate of climb to drop. Initially, this performance loss is subtle. But once the speed falls below the minimum drag speed, the airspeed decreases rapidly. When the stall warning is triggered, you might not have enough thrust to overcome the increased drag. The only option left is to push the nose down firmly, treading altitude for airspeed. This is very different from the stall recovery techniques you practice when learning to fly. All of this is critical because what we learn early in our career is what will remain in our muscle memory for the rest of our life. Here are some accidents where aircraft stalled in icing conditions. Northwest Orient Airlines Flight 6231, Boeing 727, 1974. The crew failed to act at the pitot tube heating. Ice formed in the pitot tube, causing the indicated airspeed to increase with altitude. The pilot reacting by pulling the nose up. As they climbed through level 240, the rate of climb exceeded 6,500 feet per minute. 10 seconds later, the stick shaker went off, but the pilot mistook it for an overspeed buffet and continued pulling the nose up. This led to a stall and loss of control. West Caribbean Airways Flight 708, McDonnell Douglas MD-80, 2005. The crew attempted to climb above icing conditions, but ended up above the aircraft's cruise ceiling. Turning on the anti-icing systems, which use engine bleed air, reduced engine thrust. The speed decreased, triggering the stall warning. The pilot pulled the nose up, causing the aircraft to enter a deep stall from which recovery was impossible. Colgan Air Flight 3407, Bombardier Q400, 2009. The aircraft was on approach in icing conditions when the stall warning activated. The pilot responded by pulling the nose up, leading to a stall. Air France flight 447, Airbus A330, 2009. Ice crystals blocked the pitot tubes, which caused the autopilot and auto thrust systems to disconnect. The aircraft transitioned from normal low to direct low. The pilot pulled the nose up, leading the aircraft into a deep stall. Aero Caribbean flight 883, ATR 72500. The aircraft encountered severe icing and stalled. The pilot responded by pulling the nose up, causing the aircraft to enter a deep stall. In all these cases, the pilot responded incorrectly by pulling the nose up, resulting in loss of control. Did ice directly cause these accidents? Not at all. Icing was just one of several contributing factors. What really stuns me is that none of the pilots understood the aircraft was stalling. And if you do not understand you are in a stall, you cannot recover. And if you do not understand you are in a stall, you cannot recover. Should we reconsider how we train and prepare pilots for stall prevention and recovery? As history demonstrates again and again, no aircraft is immune to mismanagement. I will greatly appreciate hearing your thoughts about this topic. Please feel free to share your opinions in the comment section below. And that's all for this time. Thank you for watching. Have a wonderful day and happy learning.
Speed is 40, 30, 20.